week. We did for about 2 weeks now, last week and the week before, we have been doing the presentation on social relations. The presentations were well done, most of them. Just a little few tweaks for the presentations, but I think your understanding how to write, I would love for you to come in to do a writing test to put that practice, to see how well you write under exam condition. Right, but overall, I think that you are doing well. I want to hear the feedback from you before I go into the question. How do you like the Peel approach? Are you still struggling with the Peel approach? Do you think you're better able to answer the questions? Those are some of the questions. Let us hear from you, please.
Sir, it's much easier to do now. It's much, much easier.
Go ahead for me, Christian.
Yes, sir. It's much easier to do now because I don't consider it as hard as before.
Okay. All right. Good, good. Any other feedback?
Sir, for the most part, I have a better understanding than before. There's some parts of it, like for the various questions where it really has to do with how you visualize the question to answer it in the Peel approach. But apart from that, the method is good.
All right, good. Any other comments? Do you think that you are better able to answer the questions, Norman, Janelle?
Yes, sir. At first, I was just putting my information, summing up in one point, but I basically realized you just have to summarize it in three paragraphs.
All right, good. What about you, Williams?
Sir?
Yes?
I think it's fine.
You think it is fine? You feel if you're going to the exam and you get this very same question, you'll be able to manage it?
Maybe.
Maybe. All right. But you still need some more practice, correct?
Yes, sir.
All right. Good, good. So you will get some more practice on it because the aim of the aim is to prepare for the final exam, which is CSEC next year. And not only to prepare you for CSEC, but also for you to, give me a second, please. Yes, ladies. So the aim is to prepare you for the final exam. And so when you're going to the final exam and you see the question, you know how to write. And that is not that you don't know the information. The issue is the writing. And so we have to improve that, because if we're able to improve that, then next time when you get an exam, I should be able to see more 80s and 90s in the exam. Nobody getting 100 because I don't give hundreds, right? But you can get up to 95 in an exam. All right, ladies. When you go to CXC, they will give you the 100. But for now, you're working with 95 as the highest. But overall, I think from the presentations, my only issue with the presentation is that I'm not sure if all students participate in the activity, right? Because no student, just one group would have messaged me and said, sir, this person is not working with me, but I'm not getting any complaint to say this person is not doing the work hard back. So I'm not, from what I'm seeing you have presented, I'm guessing that everybody would have contributed to the work. All right. So let us look at, I think this is where we left off. Reasons for some enslaved. Why is it, are we family life? Where we left off last class?
So I think family life.
Okay, good. All right. So if we look at family life and slavery, whites tend to have a lot of nuclear families, right? In the sense that nuclear is the mother, the father, and the children that live in the great house. Not only nuclear family for the rich whites, but also those who were like the overseers also lived with their families. Nuclear family, and the bookkeepers also live in a nuclear way. So we can safely say that there was some level of nuclear family. I remember that most of the whites were Christians. And if they were Christians, Roman Catholics, for the French and the Spanish territories, for the English territories, most of them would have been Protestants or Anglican. And if they are Christians, then the Christian church encouraged that type of family life. However, although the planter had his wife living at the home, well, living in the house, either the great house or the overseer's house or the bookkeeper's house, the whites, especially the males, tend to have a sexual relationship with the enslaved woman, right? Or several enslaved women, yes. So they fathered many, many children with the enslaved woman. We have, for example, a planter by the name of Thomas Thistlewood. He was a planter in Jamaica, Thomas Thistlewood, and he was, I'm not even sure to say if he was in love, but he had quite a lot of sexual relationship with his enslaved woman. Not one, more than one, but there was one particular one that he loved. And I want to put the word love in quotation because some people say it was abuse. One historian recently I heard on the radio said that it was an abuse. However, from what I read in the diary, it seems as if they had a love relationship and her name was Phibia. So Thomas Thistlewood had a lot of sexual relationship with the enslaved woman. And one of his favorite persons, and she tend to wield a lot of power, Phibia, right? She tend to feel as if she was in control. And then I remember one group would have presented that some Blacks felt that they had certain privilege because they had sexual relationship with the planter. Can't remember which group that was, but that was a phenomena. That was a reality on some of the enslaved plantations. Now, that basically covers family life. And I wouldn't, I'm not so sure if I agree with you with the term stable. Because if you have stable family, how is it that you have mistresses? What's your take on that? Do you think stable is the correct term to use?
I guess if there is no problem in their marriage, say, I guess it's stable.
It is stable, all right. So we could use the word stable, even though he is what they call is cheating with the enslaved. But it, how is it that he's cheating? Because they said that the enslaved woman or enslaved people were considered, they were not human beings, they were property. I'm not even sure how to interpret this or to wrap my mind around it. And then we have also the narrative about Annie Palmer from Rosa Greathouse, that she also would have killed quite a lot of her husband, and she was sexually involved with the enslaved males, right? So family life for the whites, that's how they portray themselves to be nuclear because of the church. Let us look at the free colored. Notice what I'm saying, free colored and free blacks. These were persons who were either were given their, what is the M word?
Manumission.
Very good. Or they purchased their manumission, their freedom. Now, the free colored are the free blacks, which is two different groups, but they fall in one category because they were freed. Family life was encouraged between them. The free colored could marry the free blacks. The free blacks could marry the free colored, but the free colored could not marry the whites, and the blacks were not allowed to marry the whites. So there was restriction. Although a lot of free colored had relationship with whites, and a lot of free blacks also had relationship with whites, not only the enslaved people. And so the free blacks in the years 1643 to 1800s, the free blacks in Barbados were allowed to get married in the churches. So when you look at the enslaved records, and these are records that the church left back, and when you look at those records and you look at the wedding registry where they write down who get married at the date that they get married and all of these different stuff, there are information there that say that the free blacks were actually free blacks got married in church, in the churches there. However, let us look at the enslaved people. Quite a lot of dynamic groups here. Very interesting groups. Now, this historian by the name of Kenneth Stamp, he said that slavery broke up African families. Do you agree with Kenneth Stamp? Slavery broke up African families. Do you agree with him?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Tell me why you agree with him.
Because the slave owners can send them away to the different plantations.
True. Yes, that's an excellent point. Any other way?
They were separated in West Africa when they were kidnapping them and making them go away from their families and go to the ship to the Americas.
Very good. Very good. Very good. Excellent point. And that is true. Now, during slavery, the planters, and I want to say, in the French territories, enslaved people were allowed to get married. French, but in the Spanish and the British territories, especially the British, they did not encourage them to get married. And so the women, the enslaved women, were more seen not as mothers, but they were seen more as to reproduce for the plantation. So if she reproduced a lot of children, then the planter would get a lot of workers, right? The males on the plantation, the enslaved males, were considered studs or the sperm donors. So what they do, I don't know if you have anybody really know about country life, or you're familiar with country. And it is the same thing. In the country, or even those people, I had a friend who had some dogs, right? We call them dogs again. The expensive one, pit bull. And what he did was that he would get the female dogs to reproduce, to have, you know, sexual relation with the pit bull, so they could have offspring. And so the offspring, what they use the offspring to do is to sell those dogs. And those dogs are very expensive, right? Same thing when you have, like, in the rural areas, they would do the very same thing with the goats, to get a lot of goats and encourage the relationship, the cows, all of these different stuff. Therefore, it was the same mentality that they had. Remember, they didn't see Africans as human beings. They saw us as properties. And it was the same thing that they did, where they encouraged the males to just go and have sexual relationship with the females, female enslaved, just for reproduction. So they did not father the children. But there were some males, enslaved males, who said, I know that I got this lady pregnant, this enslaved woman pregnant. I live on a different plantation, and he would run away for short periods, sometimes for the night alone. Because enslaved people just don't run away for a long time. There are two types of runaways. You have short term or temporary, which we call petit marinage. And grand marinage is when you run away and you don't come back. So for the petit marinage, you run away for the night, or you run away for the day, and you go and look for your child or your children and your girlfriend on another plantation. So this is what we call visiting union. This started out in slavery, where the male and the female live two separate places, but the male would visit. They know that they're in a relationship together. He doesn't live there, but he visits. Another thing, another slave phenomena that happened is, yes, more like a long distance relationship. Another phenomena that happened in slave family was, some of them, even though the church didn't permit them to get married, or the state and the planters didn't permit them to get married, some of them decide that they are going to get married. And so one historian, which is a very good friend of mine, his name is Tyler Parry, not Perry. Tyler Parry. He's a professor in the US, and he wrote a book, Jumping the Broom. Have you ever watched any show before where they jump the broom?
Yes, sir.
All right. Now, the jumping the broom during the marriage is something that happened in slavery, from during the period of slavery. And so what the enslaved people did to show that they were together or they were married was that they had their little ceremony and they would jump the broom. So instead of putting on ring and signing paper, they would jump the broom, and that was a sign of their marriage. So even though they didn't encourage them to get married, the enslaved people still find ways or created ways to show everybody that both of us are together. So if a man and a woman in a relationship, once you see them jump the broom, everybody know that, listen, these two people, they are married couples, nobody should interfere. You see how history is important, and we see a lot of shows about jumping the broom. All right, ladies, another phenomenon that happens is that most of the enslaved men fathered many children. So there was a lot of polygamy. They had more than one woman, right? And the enslaved family, because the women were usually were the ones who had the children and they kept those children. You had a lot of matrifocal families where the females had a lot of control. But not only that, slavery broke off families because there are times when the enslaved woman, where a mother was separated from her child at birth, very painful situation. So it is not only the removal of the husband from the wife, but there were a lot of situations where the mothers were separated from their child or children. Very, very sad situation when it comes to enslaved family life. So as I mentioned before here, historian Tyler Parry, he did his research on slave marriages, and he mentioned that John Luftman in 1787 in Antigua, he said that slaves were not permitted to marry. And so, although the enslaved persons were not permitted to get married, guess what? They performed their own ceremony by jumping the broom. Hope everybody know about the jumping the broom. And that's why a lot in America today, a lot of the Black communities jump the broom. I think I was watching a show about 2 weeks ago on BET, where it was like, how the show go again?
Sir, is it about like the mother-in-law didn't like the girlfriend?
Yes.
And
she didn't like the girlfriend, and there was just some other problem going on before the wedding.
Yep. Yes. And then the mother of the daughter never wanted her to jump the broom. They never wanted to do that.
Yes, that is the same show. And the mother-in-law was very, that is the husband or the groom's mother. She was very determined that they must jump the broom. In fact, she said that this has been a family tradition for years. That was her exact statement. So in the US, especially in Black communities in the US, they are very, very, pay a lot of attention when it comes to the jumping the broom. And you see that into the shows today. All right. Now, let us look at the relationship between the master, and these are the white males on the plantations, and the enslaved people. So one, they usually contact in the field. That was one of their main way of contacting each other. And they usually observe them on parades from their veranda. So especially during the Christmas time, enslaved people were allowed to parade. That's what we call jankuno. So jankuno is when they would dress up in these different, anybody know of jankuno?
Yes, sir.
You know that when they put on the different stuff, they were mocking the planters. The enslaved people were mocking the planters and said that they were devils and all of these different stuff. And the planters were there, the whites were there laughing and felt that it was good. They were, you know, parading for them. But in fact, they were mocking them and calling them the devil. So parades were places where they interact together. And some enslaved were invited to perform acts of amusement at parties. Some of them had sexual relations. Whites had sexual relations with the enslaved women. And I give perfect example of that, Thistlewood and Phibia. And it was illegal, it was against the law for whites to have sexual relations with blacks. However, the society turned a blind eye to it. They pretend like they don't observe. You know, you mind your own business, that type of thing. You see the baby come out and the babies look whitish, you know, well, colored, but sometimes the babies were born and you could say the baby's full white, how close the baby would come. But the society pretend as if nothing happened, right? Now let us look at the relationship between the white woman and the enslaved woman. It was a hostile relationship, very hostile. The white woman didn't treat the enslaved woman good. And in fact, the white women, or some of the colored women, they had taverns or brothels. And these are where they prostitute the enslaved women. So you had a lot of ships that came to the Caribbean. And what they did was that they set up little houses. And what they did in the houses was that those sailors who sail on the ship, those merchants, those military persons who command the colony to ensure that enslaved people are behaving well, they would prostitute them, the enslaved women, to them also. And so that was a very hostile relationship. And at times, the enslaved women used to mock the enslaved women used to mock the white women about their husband because they slept with their husband. So when the white women were in the house and they were talking, they laughed at them and both of them, like the cook and the one who, the cook, and said, look, I'm sleeping with her husband and she has no idea. So there was a sense of mockery. A lot of hostility take place between the white woman and the enslaved woman. In fact, my wife always tell me that woman is woman's greatest problem, because women, most of the things that females are doing is really to please other women, because you don't want people to say you dress a particular way and all of these different stuff. So it's like a lot of competition between women, all right? So that is one. Now, so we look at the relationship, how the different groups relate to each other. The last one is that whites and enslaved paired each other on a typical Caribbean plantation. Yes. They feared each other. Why? Whites were very small in number. So you're writing about this. You give the numbers, the ratio between whites and blacks. The blacks were the largest group. And so they feared them. The enslaved would rebel and destroy their property and equipment or kill them. There were times where the Africans, the blacks, killed the whites. But if you strike a white man, whether even a small little strike, it is instantaneously you are put to death. Right? And the enslaved, the whites were very fearful of the enslaved because they could poison the food. Who is preparing the food?
Sir, the domestics.
The domestics preparing the food. And so there were times when the domestic would poison the food of the whites. And one of the biggest fear that the whites had, and they put laws in place and said, Africans, you could not beat drums, you could not dance, you could not do certain things. They were fearful that the Africans would obey them. They were fearful of that. So there was a sense of fear in the whites towards the enslaved people. All right, so there was fear between the whites and the enslaved, but also not only the whites feared the enslaved, but the enslaved also feared the whites. Because one, the enslaved, they put laws in place and different regulations that ensure that the Africans were belittled. Also, the whites had superior weapons. They had guns and ammunition. They had armies. They had the ships that, the naval ships that patrol the sea. And so they were very, very fearful of the military. And they were also fearful that if they should rebel against the whites, that they could sell them to other plantations or they could separate their families. So they were very, very fearful. And also, the enslaved were fearful because the whites basically created a sense of inferiority in them. And the worst thing in life, ladies, is when somebody controls you psychologically. Oh, yes. Psychological control is a terrible control. If somebody should look at you every day and tell you that your nose big, your lip big, your forehead big, and just always commenting on your physical feature, you're black, and black now becomes something that is bad. You're black like tar. They would say things like, your hair is nappy, your hair is not good. Those psychological control by the whites, even today, we are still grappling with those effects. Still, because some people behave, as some people have in the back of their mind, and I've heard it already, anything black not good. That's something that the whites used to say to the enslaved people, and we still say it today. Same thing with your hair. Your hair is good, your mix, you have good hair, or you say that somebody here is bad because it is nappy, right? Because of the texture of their hair. You said the hair is bad. No, those things can affect people psychologically. And hips, they used to complain. The white women used to complain the white women used to complain to the used to mock the enslaved women that their bottoms were or hips were too big and their lips are too big. Right now everybody put in going to the different, we call that center, the medical
plastic place. Surgeons.
Yes, the plastic surgeon to have lips, to insert things to get the lips big and to get the hips big. Can you imagine?
So but, it's really ironic how, like, they complain about how we're black and all of that, but at the same time they're still sleeping with the black women. If you never think so, why you sleep with her? I don't ever hear men say them sleep with a woman that they don't like. You know what I'm saying?
That is so true. That is true. It's a lot of contradiction. But they put, and then another reason for the fear that the whites had, sorry, the blacks had for the whites, was the punishments that they also received. They used to cut off mutilation, cut off the hand, cut off the fingers. They used to allow one enslaved person to defecate in another enslaved person's mouth. Yes, Thomas Thistlewood, he said he loved Phibia, he was in love with Phibia, but he allowed Derby to defecate in Egypt's mouth as a form of punishment, and also death. Some of them would have received death. So the type of punishment that they would have received also draw fear in them. So it is not only that they had superior weapon, or they had the military, or they were fearful that they could separate their families, or because they psychologically control their minds, that even today, we as descendants of enslaved people, we still think that particular way. Where we see good, we define here based on good and bad. And we still today, if somebody knows is big, we said, oh, that person knows big, other person part big, other person they're black. And if you see a black cat in Egypt, black cat is something that brings good luck. But during slavery, anything black is bad. So you have black market, which is a bad market. The black spot is where every accident happens. The black male, right? You wear black to go to funeral or to mourn. Anything black is considered bad, and that is one of the effects of slavery.
Sir.
Go ahead.
So I keep on hearing you saying, oh, they only, like, you only put how they had sexual relationships with women. But I don't see you say they have sexual relationships with the black men either.
Because, all right, so there are more evidence for the, it happens. One of the story that I mentioned was with, what do you call that person name? Annie Palmer from Roosevelt Great House. It was said that she had a lot of relationship with the enslaved males. But I wonder if it was prevalent. I wonder. I know for sure in the Caribbean, another thing I might not mention here, but in sixth form, if you do history in sixth form, you study more about this. In sixth form, you look at how the enslaved, the white males sodomize the enslaved males. That was also a phenomenon that was very popular.
And sir, and they said the effect of that is now that men are wearing their pants at their bottoms.
That's what I've heard. And it could be, But it was terrible. Slavery was not anything that was nice. And teaching about the history is not that you should hate whites. No. No, that's not the reason. Because most of the persons studying about slavery today are white people. But is that we as the world should never go back there. And some of the negative things of slavery, especially the psychological control, we need to get those away, get them from out of our thought. Don't define here based on good and bad. Don't say somebody is black and ugly. Or she pretty for a black girl.
And some of them look set up. It's like, what is that supposed to mean?
Yes, that is one of the negative effects of slavery, because the whites used to say, oh, she's so beautiful or she's so pretty for a black child. Effects. You see, our history is important because it points us to some of the things that happened in the past and how those things continue to linger us today. So, ladies, when we meet tomorrow, we are going to look at the forest industry. And then I want us to leave it at the forest industry so you can enjoy your Easter break. If you celebrate Easter, you enjoy Easter break. If you celebrate Passover, you enjoy your Passover. All right, ladies. Thank you for the discussion, ladies. And we meet again tomorrow morning.
Bye, sir.
Bye-bye.
Sir.